Well, good afternoon. All right. Okay, then. Turn to the person next to you, look them right in the eyes, and say, "You are good looking." And then you say, "Not as good looking as me, but very good looking." Oh, all right. It's good to see you. You guys having a good day? Yes? Amen? All right, good. Someone's like, "No, I am not. Thank you for asking." How am I? Well, thank you for asking. I'm delightful. Thank you for asking. Thank you. I feel good. I wanted to start, if we could, with a quick video. This is a video we put together a few months back at LifeTeen. And I don't know if you've ever wondered, ever thought about this. Do you ever think about how lucky we are that our thoughts don't appear above our head, or that our sins don't appear above our head? Can you imagine? It would make confession a lot easier. You walk in, you're just wearing all of your sins. You'd be like, "I'm here to save you time, Father." But just consider for a second, if everything you thought and everything you've done was exposed to somebody else. Just take a quick look.
Hey, Evelyn. Hi.
Hey, Brendan.
So, I was wondering, you're super pretty. I mean, I know that you were
looking... That's a lot of sticky notes. You feeling forgetful today?
Not really. So, were you gonna go to homecoming?
What are these?
They're just sticky notes. Look, Evelyn, I would really like to take you to homecoming if no one's asked you yet.
Missed mass to watch Mythbusters. Lied to my mom about my chemistry grade.
You don't have to read those.
Then why are they on your body?
It's kind of a long story. It's sort of an answer to prayer. Look, Evelyn, it doesn't matter. You're hot and stuff, and I would really like to go to the dance with you if you feel like it.
Slow down, Brendan. Look, you can't just walk up to me with your dirty laundry hanging out and ask me out. Explain all this.
Okay, look. Obviously, these are my sins, okay?
Shh. And why did you stick them to your body?
I didn't. I prayed that God would help make me a better person, and then this just happened. They just came out of nowhere. And the worst part is, I can't get rid of them. If I pull one off, it just reappears again.
That's crazy.
Yeah, it is.
So how are you supposed to make them go away?
You tell me. I can stop new ones from coming as long as I don't sin, which I'm getting better at, but I'm stuck with these.
Have you shown Father Matt?
No. I'm pretty sure Father Matt is the one who voodoo cursed me.
You shouldn't accuse a priest of doing voodoo. Father Matt would never.
Crud.
Have you tried going to confession?
No, no way. I haven't got a confession in, like, years, okay? I'm pretty sure Father Matt would make it worse.
Father's just here to help. Besides, it looks like you need it.
So for the dance, do you want to go with me? You're just so hot, you know?
Look, how about you take care of your sin problem first, and then ask me again? And next time, think of a better compliment.
Bye, love you too.
Is that all? Anything else you need to confess?
I think that's everything.
Anything voodoo related?
Yeah, there's one more. I accused you of practicing voodoo.
They didn't teach us that in seminary. Really, you need to come to confession more often. Sin separates you from God, separates you from others. It makes it very difficult to truly connect with another person.
Yeah, I couldn't connect with Evelyn earlier. She wouldn't even give me an answer when when I asked her to homecoming.
Let me guess, did you call her hot and expect her to be flattered by it?
Yeah, is that not charming?
No, not charming.
Hmm. All right. Well, next time, what if I told her, like, hey, I like your hair?
I think that's a start.
Because you're hot.
I love that video for so many reasons. Guys, we're so stupid. He's like, yeah, we are! I had a great time. I got to spend time with the men this morning. We have some really great men at this conference. Yes, we do. But I'd be lying if I said I wasn't excited to be here now. This smells a lot better in here. So, ladies, it's good to see you. You know, this video. We're really, really good at playing word games in this world. I don't mean like words with friends, you know. I mean we're good with playing word games. We find ways to not admit our sin. We find ways to say we're sorry without saying we're sorry. In fact, we don't really even use words anymore. Now we just kind of use emojis. Now we're like an emoji culture. Like, I can't be bothered to be typing words. I'll just type a funny symbol of a smiley face. Yeah. Or a fist bump. Or poop. You know, whatever it is, right? But we've gotten to this place now where we don't really communicate. We have a hard time making eye contact. And then even when we do, we play word games. I'll give you an example. When I used to go to confession, back when I was a teenager, I was so uncomfortable saying my sins that I had like a little pre-programmed thing I would do. I'd go in and be like, hey, bless me, Father, for I have sinned. It's been way too long since my last confession. And, you know, I stubbed my toe and said, darn. And then I didn't share, you know, the mashed potatoes with my sister. You know, and then I pushed 14 nuns down the stairs and broke their legs. And, you know, then I had sex with 47 people. And then I shot my neighbor. And then I didn't stay for the final blessing at Mass. Amen. And it's like you put, like, all the big ones in the middle. And you kind of try to sandwich the little ones on the outside. Or I'd go to Father and I'd be like, yeah, you know, I did this. And then a bunch of other stuff I can't really think of, which I'm actually thinking about right now. And actually, I want to go do it again. But then I'd be like, I'm not really confessing it because I'm actually in confession. So what I'd do is, like, I would say I couldn't remember it or a bunch of other stuff because I was too embarrassed to say it. I wanted to play word games. And we're really good at a culture at playing word games. And what ends up happening is that God is not into word games. Like, if he was into word games, he wouldn't have given us this book. He wouldn't have given us 73 books written by 45 authors over 1,700 years, which lays out for us what is and is not okay, what we should and shouldn't do, and how we should and shouldn't live. He makes it very clear to us. God is very clear. We like to be like, well, you know, God is mysterious, so who can really figure him out? And actually, you know what he says in Deuteronomy? I am not mysterious. He says, my ways are not too mysterious for you. I'm not that hard to figure out. There's a right and there's a wrong. There's a good, there's a bad. But see, we like to kind of function in that area of gray. You know, it's like, hey, you know what? You're not supposed to have sex outside of marriage. He puts a line right there. A man and a woman under the sacrament of marriage, they're the ones that I call to have sexual relations. He makes a line and we're like, yeah, but you know, I love him. We put our foot over the line. I love her. And you're like, but we're engaged, but we're committed, but it's homecoming, but it's Arbor Day, or whatever it is, right? And we play word games. We love to find the loophole. Instead of seeking the Lord, we seek the loophole. And then we're shocked when it doesn't go well. Someone doesn't like what the Bible says, so all of a sudden they try to say, well, the Bible is wrong. Why is it wrong? Because it doesn't agree with what I say. It says right there, don't judge. It says right there, don't judge, judgy judges. And why are you judging my judgings? And did you read what it said after that? I don't have to. Stop judging me. Can I ask you another question? Yes. Okay. Are you an idiot? You can't just like pick and choose. Oh, I like this verse, but I don't like that verse. If we only pick the verses we like and we exclude the verses we don't like, it's not the Bible you believe. It's yourself. It's like someone doesn't like what a priest teaches, so I don't like the church anymore. Someone doesn't like what this person says, well, I don't like that faith, and I don't like that faith. And you know what ends up happening? They leave, and they go start their own faith. And I tried it. I was 16 years old. We had the religion of Mark. It was great. I didn't worship the Holy Trinity of Father, Son, and Spirit that the Cardinal talked about this morning. No. I worship the minor Trinity of me, myself, and I. And it was great. The world, it just revolved around me. I'd tilt my head to the side, and the waves would come in. It was awesome. I was the only member of our church. We were totally broke and destined for hell. I wanted a religion at 16 where I could smoke as much weed as I want, drink as much as I want, have as much sex as I want, and still go to heaven. You know what? It doesn't work that way. I kept trying to figure out if I can just find the loophole, I'll be good. And that was the wrong way of thinking. You see, because it was all about me. And I was fascinated because I'd go to Mass, I'd be like, is this God's plan to bore me to death? Because, you know, Mass is all about me. It's not really about the God of the universe pouring out his body and blood in such a way that he wants to fill us with his body and blood in a divine blood transfusion so that we would be so filled with God's life and grace we could go out into the world and affect change. No. It's about me. It's about if I like the songs. It's about if I feel like paying attention. It's about if I feel like making fun of the altar servers who can't seem to find a gown that goes to the ground. It's all about me. It's not about the prayers that the priest is saying on the altar. No. It's about me wanting to pull out my last hair because someone moved the ribbon in the book. I'm sitting there going, you do this every day. It's all about me. I don't like that song. I don't like what that priest said. I don't like what that scripture verse said. I don't like what that person said. So I'm just going to sit in my me puddle with my iPhone and take selfies of me. And this is why the Catholic Church is so awesome. This is why you should feel so blessed to be part of the Catholic Church. Because the Catholic Church, in all of her love, comes right up into your face and right up into your grill and goes, you know what? It ain't about you. And that's a really good thing. You see, what I used to want to do is I wanted God to rubber stamp all my plans. I was going to go up to God and go, here's how it's going to go, God. I want to follow you somewhat. I'd like to be part of your family for the most part. I'd like you to send me a very hot girlfriend. I'd like you to send me riches and a good job. I want you to allow me to go off to some university where I can moderately follow you and do whatever I want to do for 5 years if I decide to graduate that quickly and be informed by the greatest atheist professors I choose to see. So I can then go off into the world and find an even hotter spouse and a perfect home with a picket fence and two little kids who look just like me who will help with yard work and a little dog and not a minivan, no, a Hummer, thanks. And see, Lord God, this is my plan. So if you just go ahead and rubber stamp that plan, just sign it, we'll be good. I'll even tell people to pray to you. Glad I could help, Yahweh. And we laugh, and we're like, oh, it's so stupid. That's what we do. We pick and choose the rules we like. We pick and choose what parts we want to follow. We pick and choose the parts of the church we want to obey. We pick and choose the commandments we want to follow. And then if we don't want to follow them so we don't feel bad, what we really do is we just justify it. I'm in love. We're engaged. It's homecoming. It's National Flag Day. You know what I mean? That's what we do. I'm going to find ways to justify my selfishness. I'm going to find ways to justify my sin because I just don't want to feel bad. You know, the Catholic Church with all their guilt always making you feel bad. I love when people say that. I'm like, really? Because I've never had the Pope knock on my door and be like, you are a sinner. Repent or I will kick you in the head. You know, it's like... Pope Francis hasn't been calling my cell, although I hope he does. I sent him a text. I keep waiting. He doesn't call my cell and be like, you should feel guilty. You're horrible. You know what the church does? The church says, I love you too much to leave you in the darkness. Because a soul who doesn't care about you is not going to pull you out of the darkness. The person that cares about you is going to do everything they can to pull you out of the darkness. That at these Steubenville conferences and weekends like this, you might think that you're the one that's pursuing God. You might think you're the one that's chasing after God. You might think, hey, you know what? I'm finally paying attention. I'm going to go in this church kind of camp retreat conference thing. I'm going to go, and I'm going to be open to you, God. And you think you're the one doing the effort because we're so focused on us. And although that's great, it's great. I never would have had the courage to come to a Steubenville conference when I was 16. I never would have had the courage. I have the utmost respect for every single one of you. whether you wanted to be here or whether you thought you were going to lacrosse camp and your mom totally lied to you. I have the utmost respect for the fact that you're here, because I never would have been here. It's just, it's amazing. I respect you. But even when you think you're the one that's pursuing God, I got news for you. It's the other way around. He is pursuing you. Last night, Leah mentioned the good shepherd. Paul mentioned the thief, the enemy who comes to steal. The good shepherd who calls you to life. You might think you're the one that's chasing after God. My brothers and my sisters, make no mistake. He's the one who's chasing after you. He's the one who knew 16 years ago that you were going to be here at this moment in time because he wanted to speak to you. He had something he wanted to tell you, something he wanted to remind you. And you're like, but I wasn't even here 16 years ago. That's how big God is. He knew. He knew when your mom and dad ran into each other at Applebee's. He's like, this is part of the plan. They're going to fall in love over mozzarella sticks. And then in 15 years, she's going to come to Steubenville, New York City. And then someone's going to tell her how much I love her. God knew. Before I got married, I had this dog. He was the dumbest dog on the planet. I don't just mean he was stupid. I mean he was really, really dumb, but quite lovable. He was a chow. I don't know if you've ever seen a chow before. They're those big, big, furry. They look like grizzly bears. Kind of like a cross between grizzly bear and Chewbacca, actually. It's like, okay, it looked just like a chow, okay? And he was huge, and they're really vicious. They were actually the guard dogs for the Chinese emperors centuries ago. I had this chow, and I was single at the time, and I thought I was, like, cool because I had, like, this killer dog, you know? And I thought it would be so cool. I'd be, like, walking around with this killer dog, and I'd be like, don't mess with me. I'm a prophet, and I have a killer lion dog, you know? And that was so cool. Then it turns out he's just dumb as soap. I mean, he's just, right? So one day, I mean, any chance he'd get, he'd always try to get out the front door. I tried to train him. I took him to dog trainers, constantly trying to get out the front door. One day, it's early in the morning, so for a youth minister, that's like 10 o'clock. And I was working as a youth minister at the parish, and the doorbell rings, and like, and I'm just like, I'm still getting the eye crusty boogers out of my eyes. I got the sheet marks. I got the breath that could kill a yak. I got hair in another zip code. I'm like, you know, going to the front door in my boxers. Ding dong, you know, the dog's just, you know, and I'm kind of there, and there's like someone like with a delivery, so I'm like, I'm hiding behind the door, and all of a sudden I'm a prisoner in my own house because I'm in my underwear, and I'm like kind of crawling around the house in my underwear until the guy leaves. He leaves, I'm kind of almost down on all fours. I open the door, and I open the security door to get the box that the delivery guy just left. I reach out to get the box, and this dumb dog thought it was a scene out of Prison Break. And I'm like this, and he, like, 45-pound dog goes running, jumps up on my back, and jumps out, and it's on. So he goes running down the street. Now, it's like January. It's about 30 degrees, 20 degrees outside. I'm in my boxers, and I live one block down from a really major intersection. And this dog is just, and I'm like, okay, I got a choice. I can go get some clothes on and possibly lose my dog forever, or I can go after him in my boxers. Let's do this. Thank God Instagram was not a thing yet. That's all I'm going to say, right? Some retired lady like, oh, Lord, Ethel. Show me how to Instagram me on the book face. You know, whatever. So she goes running. So I go running after the dog. Now I run down. I'm like calling his name. And he would like kind of tease me. He'd like run. He'd gallop. He'd stop. He'd turn back. He'd be like. And I'd be like, come here, buddy. Come here. And I get like within about 15 yards. And he'd go. When he take off again, I'm like, dog! And I keep running after him, right? So we go one block, and we go two blocks. Now we're three blocks. Now we're coming in on about a half a mile away. 20-something degrees outside, boxers, loose Chewbacca. Okay? He keeps running. I keep yelling his name, and he would keep doing it. He'd stop, he'd turn, and tease me. I try to get close. Right as I got close, he'd take off again. Because he thought he was experiencing freedom. And I'm like, you're a moron! That's a Cadillac! Right? So finally, it gets like literally 3/4 of a mile from my house. I'm not even exaggerating. I get close to him. He's at like at a corner. I get down and I'm like, okay, I gotta get down to where he's at. I gotta get on his level. So I'm like, hey buddy, I'm gonna kill you. Cute dummy. And I'm like, trying to get down like this. I'm talking to him. I'm down on his level. I'm getting close. At this point, people are stopping their cars and just taking pictures of this. They're probably thinking, this guy is a meth head. This guy is a drunk. What is he doing? My boxers just, keep driving, I'm a professional. Come here, buddy. I get closer to him, and right as I get close to him, I lean in, and I'm like, And I grab him. And I pull him up into my face. And he's got that dog breath. It's just, and I'm just like, oh, so this is what hell smells like. And I lift him up. And I mean, and he's just all fur, right? And I get my arms around him, and I'm like, I'm going to kill you. And he goes, right up in my face. I'm like, oh, thank you. And now I can't let him go because he's going to run again. So I hoist him up, and 3/4 of a mile, we're now walking back to my house in my boxers. People honking, get a room. I'm like, go to purgatory, you know, whatever. Right? So we're walking home. I get home, I lock the door, and I'm like, I'm trying to chastise him, you know, make sure he doesn't do it again. You are an idiot, you know, don't do that. He's just so happy to be home. Goes in, drinks about 1/4 of water, eats about 1 bag of food, lays down, farts, goes to sleep for 4 hours. Genius relationship we had, right? And I'm so mad, I'm sitting there, I'm indignant, I'm laughing at myself. I'm like, I can't even imagine how many people have pictures of me in my boxers running around trying to get my stupid dog. I'm laughing, I'm shaking my head, I'm like, this is like the worst day ever. And it's at that moment, it's like always like in the most unexpected moments when God will just reach down from heaven with love and be like, whack. And I felt God reach down from heaven and go, oh, my son, whack. He's like, don't you get it? No, I don't, Yahweh. No. He's like, you're the dog. And it was like God was going, don't you understand? This is what you do, man. Every time I call you back into the safety of the home of heaven, the safety of the church, the safety of my arms, the safety of the relationship, every time I call your name and you run the other direction like a moron, and you keep running not just to other safety, you keep running into the world, you keep running into all these other distractions, these noises, these lights, these other things, you keep running, plunging to your peril, running to danger where you're going to die. St. Paul doesn't say in Romans 6 that sin is kind of like death. You know, sin's sort of like death-like. He goes to Romans 6, he says, sin is death. It is spiritual suicide. You are cutting yourself off from God. It does not change God's love for you. Sin does not change God's love for you. Sin destroys your ability to feel and experience and receive God's love and to share God's love. It doesn't change His love for you. And even though you are here, which I am proud of, and you are seeking God, which I am beyond excited about, that's still in a way making it about us. What is really going on here is that God is coming after you. He has been seeking you. And you've run in a lot of different directions, just like I have. Because every time we sin, we run. Maybe you've been on these before. Maybe you've been on retreats before, camps, conferences. And that's sort of like where you stop for a minute. Maybe get away from some of your friends who aren't great influences. Get away from some of their temptations. Maybe get away from your screen. Get away from the stresses of school and stuff. And that's kind of like you stopping and sort of turning back. Maybe you even make eye contact with him, but he's still at a distance. He's calling your name. He's coming for you. It's almost like you're teasing God. You're like, but he's there. He's coming. But right before you let him get his arms around you, out of fear, out of shame, out of guilt, whatever it is, right before he gets real close to you, you take off again. But make no mistake, the sheep, that's us. We can run, but the good shepherd, he runs faster. And he never runs out of energy. His energy is limitless. You have a good shepherd who, like Father was talking about last night, who's leaving the 99, he's coming for you. And especially those of you, and I know there's souls in this room who feel like you've sinned too much, you've gone too far, you've been too bad, he can never forgive you again. He's really coming after you. He's lacing up extra tight for you. And you can run, man. You can go over the hills and down the ravines and into the caves and into the valleys. And you have a shepherd who runs faster. And he's going to keep coming. He's going to keep coming. He's going to keep coming. He's going to keep calling your name because he is not content to leave you in the darkness. He is not okay with that. He doesn't want you to live in the darkness. He wants you to live in the light. He wants you to experience freedom. He does not want you to think like a lot of your other friends think. He does not want you to think like everybody else in your feed thinks. It says in Romans 12, St. Paul tells the people in Rome, he says, do not conform yourselves to this age. Do not think like these people think, because they're not thinking about God, even though God is thinking about them. He says, do not conform yourselves to this age, but be transformed by renewing your mind, by the renewal of your mind, by figuring out what God's will is for you, by doing what is good and what's pleasing and what's perfect. He's like, don't be like everybody else. Those lambs are being led to slaughter. Stop running. The Father loves you enough that he's coming right into your midst. In case you missed that earlier with the cardinal, God's not just up in heaven going, hey, Becky, stop sinning. See you when you die. God's love is too grand for that. You come here, you come into the arena, you show up on time, you participate, you worship, you go to Mass. I'm seeking God. He's like, no! That God left the splendor of heaven and took flesh as a baby, as we heard this morning. God leaves the splendor of heaven. He comes right here, right into your midst, right into your grill, and says, this is my body. What are you going to do about it? Stop running. And what do we have a chance to do when we go back at Mass? We have a chance to go back and look at the God who created us, who gave us every talent, every gift, every blessing, every skill. And when he says, here's my body, here I am, we have the chance to look him back in the eyes and go, okay, and here's my body, which is really your body, God. Every talent, every blessing, every skill, they're all yours. Use them as you want to use them. I ain't running anymore. I've tried it my way, and my way sucks. You know, I had the religion of me. I came face to face with the God of the universe. It was the best / worst day of my life. Really was the best day. But he wrecked all my plans to be famous and have money. I told the story 1,000 times because it just was the first of 1,000 conversions that meant so much to me. I was on a confirmation retreat that I was forced to go on by my mom because I was convinced that she hated me and her plan was to bore me to death. And I sat in the back of the room and I watched all the kids who were really into their faith, the other juniors. They were open, they were laughing, they were free. They could sing a song, they would listen to the people giving talks, they would listen to the people in small group. I was the really insecure guy who would just sit in the back and make fun of people because I was so insecure in myself. My only chance was to try to rip on other people who were actually way more courageous than I would ever have the chance to be. So I made everybody's life miserable that weekend. Small group leader's life, he'd ask me a question and I'd be like, like in the nativity set, I was the ox and the ass at the same time. People were singing. I'm like, no, we'll not sing. I am ox, you know. So sitting at Mass, priest comes out in his little dress thing, whatever they called it. I didn't know. I'm like, why is this dude wearing a dress? Little did I know how much actually the vestments meant. And he said the words. He took up the bread. He said the words. This is my body. It was less than a second that I opened my heart and I just said, man, what if that's God? Because I didn't just open my heart, I opened my mind. I said, what if that's God? What if that's really him? That one question gave God all the permission in the world he needed. I opened the door to my heart this much, and like a size 12 carpenter sandal went. This door is never closing, son. He wedged his foot in there, right in that door, and he pulled me really close like that stupid dog of mine. And I had my bad breath, just and God pulled me right in. He says, you're mine. I'm never letting you go. And I've tried to run since. I'm here to tell you, man, the shepherd, he runs faster. He runs faster. What are you running from? Some of you are running from yourselves. Some of you are running from expectations put on you by family members, friends, teachers, coaches, bosses. Some of you are running from your own friends that you keep nearby because you're afraid of being alone, but deep down you know are terrible for you. Some of you are running from what you already know deep down in your heart, you need to break up with somebody, you need to stop this relationship, you need to cut it off. But again, such a fear of being alone that what's that going to mean if I cut it off and I totally give my life to God? I think there's a lot of souls at this conference, a lot of souls in this room who are in that place where you're kind of turning back and you're looking at God and you see him coming for you and you're nervous. Because if you turn all the way in, you're nervous about what's going to happen. You can't control it. So you got one leg going this way, like I'm still eyeing traffic. You got one eye going this way, and you feel like this tear inside of you. I'm just here to tell you, this is why confession is so important. Because when you're dealing with sin and you haven't reconciled it yet, you can't think clearly, and you can't hear clearly, and you can't discern or decide rightly. See, souls trapped in darkness have a hard time making out the light. And that's why you want to get to confession as often as you can and as quickly as you can. Because it allows you to see again, it allows you to hear again. But I'll tell you something. This afternoon, tonight, God's probably going to ask something of you that makes you uncomfortable. He's going to ask you to walk further. He's going to ask you to stop. He's going to ask you to turn back. Not because he's trying to ruin your life, because he's trying to save it. I don't know what kind of place you're in your homes, in your relationships, in your friendships. I know what kind of situation I had. I know if I hadn't stopped finally that day and let God into my heart, even a little bit, not only would I not be Catholic today, I don't think I'd even be alive. I really don't. Did I get the riches I was looking for? No. Am I blessed beyond comprehension? Oh, yeah. I wouldn't do anything different. And I have a feeling that a lot of your chaperones and leaders feel the exact same way. I know you think they come do this kind of a weekend because it's glamorous, sleeping on really plush mattresses with awesome sheets and eating really healthy food and taking really long bus rides with people who can't keep their gas in, you know? I know you're thinking they're all at the parish, they're like fighting over it. No, I'm taking the teens to Steubenville, man. No, I am. It's going to feel awesome on my back. I want to take them. It's my turn. I know that's actually what happens behind the scenes. They're running around behind you. Please sign this permission slip for the love of God. Please just sign it. I have to turn it in. I have 19 girls named Jane Smith. Just turn it in. I want to ask you to do me a favor. I want to pray with you right now, okay? Just where you are. And I want to ask you to stick with me here, okay? I want to ask you to close your eyes, wherever you're sitting. And especially any oxes in the group who are like, I will not close my eyes. You will not violate my self-will. Okay, fine. You don't have to. I'm just going to pray against you right now. I'm just kidding. Sort of. I'm just going to ask you just to take a second, close your eyes. And wherever you're sitting, I just want you to clench your fists, clench both fists, okay? I want you to picture yourself holding really tight, like to a tarp or to a sheet in a really strong wind. You can feel like the wind's pulling it away, and you're holding on as tightly as you can, just tighter, 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 just as much strength as you have in your hands and your fists, just clench it. That sheet, that tarp, are all your fears of giving God everything. You look up, you realize this, it's not just the wind, it's God. He's on the other side. He's trying to pull it away from you. This tarp represents everything, all those false gods you put in this place, the fears, the anxieties, all the power you give to the world, the power you give to your friends, the power you give to other people. And if you're afraid to let it go, just clench it, clench it, clench it. And I want you to hear God speak to you. My son, my daughter, I love you. I've loved you since the moment that I formed you. Do not have to fear. I'm with you. I formed you in the womb. I consecrated you. I have a mission for you. I have a mission for for you, and it's only for you. I have a mission that no one else can fulfill but you. Give me your sin. Give me your fears. Give me your anxieties. Give me your struggles. Give me your loneliness. Give me your depression. Give me your stresses. Let me love you. As you're clenching, I want you to look up into the eyes of God. Look into the eyes of Jesus, who's standing across from you. And I want you to look at his face. Look right into his eyes. Keep clenching that sheet. Clench it harder. And I want you to look into his eyes while you're pulling on that sheet. What are his eyes saying to you? Look at his face right now. What is his expression saying to you? And if you're in that place where you want to go a step deeper today, you want to go a step deeper tonight, even if you're not sure what it's going to mean, maybe you just want to stop running. If you want to turn back to God, if you're in that place where you're sitting, I just want you to just to open your hands and let go. Just stop clenching it. Feel your hands open. If you're in that place where you're like, God, I've tried it my way. I've been running my way, and my way is not working. I just want you to open your hands where you are. And if you're scared to, I respect that. If you're not sure how it's going to go, I respect that. If you need to open your hands. And if you're still clenching it, that's okay. At least you're honest. But hear him say, fear not, for I am with you. For you are my child, and I am your God. And nothing you do can make me love you more, and nothing you do can make me love you less. I love you, and I will never leave you. Even when you leave me, I will not leave you. But I want you to live. Because I love you. And if you've opened your hands, if you let go, if you stop clutching that false god, and if you're willing, I want you to repeat after me this prayer, okay? Just quietly, wherever you are, just, Lord Jesus Christ, I give you permission to love me. Lord Jesus, I give you permission to be the God of my life, to wreck my plans if those plans lead me away from you. I give you my life. I give you my heart. And I give you my future. I love you, God. Thank you for loving me. Just one final thought. Okay. You don't become a saint by comparing yourself to a sinner. Some more word games. I find that a lot of the time when I don't feel like I'm doing very well in my faith walk, I compare myself to people that are worse than me instead of people who are better than me. Like, well, I'm definitely better than that guy. And God's like, yeah, that's not the bar you want to set for yourself. I just want to throw this out. God desires a relationship with you more than you could ever desire one with him. God has been trying to speak to you, sometimes through his word, sometimes through the priests, oftentimes through your leaders, your friends. And one final thought, a lot of the time through your parents. I know, we're horrible. I'll tell you something. God's ways are not too mysterious for you. I have a feeling if you give God permission and you look at the last few years of your life, he would reveal to you different voices and different people at different times who've spoken truth to you. The question is not whether or not God's been speaking to you, like Father said earlier. The question is whether or not you've put yourself in a position to listen. And I'm hoping right now on this weekend that the Spirit's putting you in a position to listen. But the question you need to ask is, as the shepherd's coming for you, are you darting for traffic and for the world? Are you frozen in fear with one foot going in this direction and one going that direction? And you're kind of running the numbers in your head about what's going to mean if you finally follow God. Or are you willing to let go, turn back, make eyes with the Father, and say, I'm yours. Wherever you lead me, I'm yours. Whatever you want from me, I'm yours. Because you made me. You made me. I'm yours, God. I really hope it's the third one. If not today, if not tonight, if not tomorrow, then soon. Because it's so sad to miss the call of God in your life. Do you know why so many of your friends are seeking validation online?
Oh, follow me, favorite it, share it, retweet it, because when you press that button, I have worth.
That button means crap. Don't get me wrong, I love Twitter. I want to be the patron saint of Twitter. I love it. But that's not where you get your worth. That's why so many of your friends are constantly checking to see if someone liked it or shared it or pressed it or responded. Because in that, they get some sort of sense of validation. What I posted was this or that. I look good in the picture. I was funny in my post, whatever it is. And that stuff's fine and good. But at the end of the day, God doesn't want you to seek your worth or your validation by what imperfect and sinful humans think of you. What the earth applauds, heaven's doing an SMH. Just, oh my gosh. And what heaven applauds, the earth crucifies. And if you want to live as a son or a daughter of God in this culture, today, in this world, there's only two things you need to remember. There is absolutely a God. And it ain't you. Let's pray. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord Jesus, Lord God, thank you so much for each and every one of the young men and women here. And Lord, thank you so much for their openness and for their courage, for their openness and their humility, God, to what you want to do in their life today, tonight, this week, and this year. And Lord, I want to pray especially for any young souls here who have very, very fear-filled hearts, Lord. Hearts filled with fear about what's going to happen next. What will it mean if I turn you? What will it mean if I follow you? God, I want to pray especially for any hearts who are still clinging to sin out of a fear of confession, God. And I just want you just to send in your Spirit. Cast out that fear. Lord God, I ask that you would bless each and every soul here, that you would bless their families and their homes, especially in homes where their families don't support their faith. Lord, I want to pray especially for any adults or any leaders here who are struggling in their marriages and their families, God, that you would bless them, that you grant them wisdom and courage and humility. I want to bless all the young souls here, especially for any of their parents who are going through hard times in their marriages and their jobs and their health. And I want to thank you for the gift, for the gift it is for me, your unworthy servant, to get to be around so much holiness and so much beauty and so much passion and so much potential in these young souls. I thank you, God. Lord, as we go forward this day and this night, I just ask that you would remind us again, you would reveal to us again how much you love us, that you would give us work until our life is over, God, and life until our work is done, and that every time we look upon you in the Eucharist, God, we're reminded not to run, but to rejoice, because we have a God who loved us enough to die for us, and a God who loves us so much he wishes to dwell in us. And Mother Mary and Saint Joseph, in a special way, I ask this night that you would kneel beside us when we pray, that you would worship beside us, and that you would pray for us, that when we look upon the monstrance, we would not see what looks like a piece of bread to the world, we look across at the monsters and see the very face of your Son as we let go of all those false gods and we follow him. And we pray as one body, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. One last thought, and I'll shut up. One last thought. We always talk about how God loves you. You know, it's right there in the Bible. God loves you. You know, and we say that. It's like a nice Catholic way to end a conversation. Okay, God loves you. Go pee now, you know. And he does love you. God is love. But sometimes I think we forget that God doesn't just love us. God likes us. He really likes us. And he gets a kick out of us. He doesn't like everything we do. But he really likes you. And he rejoices in you. And he is incredibly, incredibly happy that you're here. And so am I. I love you guys. Talk to you later. Have a good night.